We're looking at the tests for overcomers. Overcomers will accept the message of discipleship, the biblical message of discipleship, because there are other messages about discipleship. Overcomers will accept the end time message of restoration, and one of the most significant aspects of end time restoration is the restoration of the New Testament pattern of the church. Unless you're up to date on what God is doing by the Spirit, at this point, you can never be an overcomer. You will always remain on the lower level of man's ways and methods and techniques and be a part of the institutional system, at least in your mind, if not in practice or not in organization. Other tests that we set forth that overcomers will overcome the tendency towards superficiality that so characterizes much of the charismatic movement, where we just settle for the baptism, we stop there, camp out at Pentecost, and refuse to move on. And most do this where they are not made aware or are disinterested in the fact that God is baptizing them in the Spirit as a means of taking them further, deeper. Charismatics are really characterized by looking for miracles rather than for a change in their own life. Miracles, praise God for them, but you watch if it doesn't happen the next time you're in a meeting where miracles are happening or healings and things are taking place, if that isn't the limit of what they're doing. And eyes will immediately focus on the next person to see what God's going to do, see him demonstrate his power, and don't realize that he never demonstrates his power as an end in itself, but as a means to an end. Mark 16:20. They went everywhere preaching the word, God working with them, confirming the word with signs following. He isn't confirming the signs by working miracles. He's confirming his word. And his word isn't John 3:16 and that's it. That's where it starts. But there's a much deeper word, and Jesus sets it forth in the New Testament, the whole message of discipleship. We will overcome that tendency to superficiality. We will accept the deeper word. And then we were dealing with last time that overcomers will overcome the self-centered life for the crucified life. And how that this meant to give uncompromising committal to Christ. You can't give him part of your time, part of your money, part of your life, but it's everything. We hear churches and people speaking of tithing and that. There's no tithing in the New Testament. It's all his. And he says, you give according as you purpose in your heart. And if you sow sparingly, that's the way you'll reap. And some people have never figured out that law of sowing and reaping applies in every area of their life. So if you want to get out of debt, then put God first. That never means in this church put more in the offering plate, because we don't take an offering. That means as the Lord leads you. If he says send it all to Mexico to that brother down there, then send it all to Mexico. We'll praise God for it. Amen. Overcoming the self-centered life is something else that I want to deal with tonight. First of all, we said it's uncompromising committal to Christ. You can't sit on the fence. You're either hot or cold, he says. And secondly, it's uncompromising acceptance of his word, his total word. It is, in a word, trusting God to do what he says. Trusting him completely. Taking God seriously. Do you realize, and this just happens to be the burden that God has given us to say these things. If it gets too hot for you, you just have to get out of the kitchen. We just have to say them. Because if we don't, as Jeremiah said, there's a burning within us. We have to say them. We have to say what he says to say. And you see, I'm responsible for what I say. So I recognize my responsibility. I don't say it lightly. I measure my words. But most Christians do not take God seriously. If they did, they wouldn't act the way they do about his promises and word. And excuse, for example, going to a doctor, calling a doctor instead of calling the elder. Now, you don't have to call an elder to get healed. We use that because it's quite convenient, because that's one of the ways to get healed. Where God doesn't say call for the doctors, he says call for the elders. Where have we come to in Christianity that we think we have the right or privilege of choosing between the Word of God and what the churches are doing or other charismatics are doing or the fellow sitting next to you believes? He doesn't give us that option. Before we get too deeply into that, I want to remind you of what we said under one of the other points. Overcomers will accept the biblical message of faith. That was one of the tests for overcomers. They will accept the biblical message of faith. I just want to remind you of a couple of things we said there as introductory to this other idea that to overcome the self-centered life, you're going to have to take God and His Word seriously. Most Christians don't. They really don't. But we said under that other subject a couple of messages ago that the kind of faith that you often hear today being presented to charismatics by charismatics does not measure up to the New Testament message of faith. Yeah. Now, dear friends, a person with the Holy Spirit will know that's true if he'll be honest with himself, that much of what you hear, not some of it, much of it, yeah. Most of it really, by other charismatic teachers, most of what you hear does not line up with this word. Amen. I'm talking about in the faith realm now. We're not touching on other points where they may not agree with us the way we baptize or what, but the faith message is the key to understanding God's word, Old or New Testament. And much of what's being presented is little more than a modified version of what the institutional church teaches about healing, about faith, about how you get an answer to prayer. God says yes, no, maybe, perhaps, substitutes, and so on. And the Bible clearly says that if he ever answers you, it's always a yes, always, without exception. God never says no to a promise. You meet the conditions, he says, I've already said yes. For all the promises of God, not some, but all the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. Now, anyone who can read can see how that promise in 2 Corinthians 1:20 is completely out of harmony with what much is taught today under the name of faith. I mean, so many people think because they can spell faith in English, that qualifies them as a faith teacher, but it doesn't. You have to be able to spell it spiritually. And a lot of people cannot spell faith spiritually. And so the New Testament message, and it is strong and stern, but we didn't make it up. Jesus did. He set it forth. But the New Testament message of faith allows no compromise. God doesn't say, well, if you're weak, go to the doctor. Or if you're just not ready yet to drop your insurance and have assurance or whatever. He doesn't give you those options. Now, a lot of people take them as if they have that right and privilege, but you can see right away what I've already said is diametrically opposed to what a lot of people teach on their tapes and their books and send out over television and so forth. Some of the letters, I think I read one last time from a brother that said that he was in Florida and heard two well-known faith teachers now teaching. And I've heard one of them teach personally right after I got the baptism. And I never heard him say these things then. I don't believe he said them then. I think he's changed. But he said they're now teaching that you shouldn't give up your medicine, that once they pray for you, keep on your insulin, your pills, because this is the way God heals. Well, remember, we said then in that study that night, then what do these men need with the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Because that's precisely what the institutional church teaches. Then if that's the way that is, why suffer the stigma of tongues and healing and natural childbirth and all the other things that they get so upset about? Although, as I say, we don't have any teaching on natural childbirth, but we're always being confronted with the fact that we force our expectant mothers to have their babies at home and tell them that there's no other way or they can't be a part of this work. Well, what do you need with the baptism Men will always choose the easier course, we said, you know, if they're given half a chance. Then they will criticize you to rationalize, justify why they don't want to follow the Word. Now, anyone who follows the Word is going to be criticized, and if you're going to be a part of this ministry here, you might as well accept that as a part of the blessing, because you will be criticized. No, as I said before, they're saying that, you know, citing alleged cases where God healed somebody with insulin. You see, if you stay on it, that means He's healing you with it. And on pills and all. And I said, those who teach this ought to give us chapter and verse, because the Bible teaches just the opposite. Healed on insulin? No. God never heals on insulin. I don't know of a single case where God ever healed anybody on pills or by surgery. I didn't say you couldn't get healed by pills or surgery. We see this happen. Sinners get healed all the time this way. Of course, a lot of things they don't get healed for. Righteous are sinners. But that isn't what we're talking about. We're talking about the way God heals. I know a lot of people have been healed without these aids and helps. In fact, as I cited, I know several people that God told just the opposite to what these men are now teaching. Told them directly. Now, I just as soon believe them as to believe those who are teaching contrary to the Word. I'd rather believe those that say, God said directly to me, I'm not going to heal you by medicine or with medicine. In fact, you're not going to be healed until you get off your pills. And even to the extreme of taking a dose of cough medicine. You see, if it doesn't have the drug in it, it isn't going to help you. You might as well go in the kitchen and get some sugar water. So cough syrup is just a drug. It's filled with codeine. A lot of people drink codeine when they can't get the drugs to get high or lower, however you end up. So with that in mind, I want to stress tonight how we must overcome the self-centered life. And to do that, we must make uncompromising committal to Jesus and make uncompromising committal to His Word. We must accept it without reservation. We must believe all He said. We must take God seriously. God is going to hold us accountable if we don't take Him seriously. He said what He meant. You don't need an interpreter for most of these great truths. John said you didn't in 1 John 2. He says you have no need for any man to teach you the essentials. The Spirit in you will teach you. That if God said, call for the elders of the church if you're sick, that they'll lay hands on the sick and they'll recover, Mark 16, that means what it says. It doesn't mean call the doctor. It doesn't mean take drugs or have surgery or whatever. It means what it says. Now, many who believe they have given up the self-centered life contradict that by the fact that they haven't overcome their doubts and their fears concerning trusting the Word of God. These are the most self-centered people you will ever meet. People who are afraid to trust God. They're centering all of their attention upon their welfare, their health, how they feel, their family, their job, their financial status and all. They're afraid to trust God instead of the bank or whatever. And they think they have to help God, you know, with their ministry and get involved in all sorts of organizationalism and institutionalism, that God couldn't do it just with the Spirit like He did with Paul, that you got to have all this organization and promotion. And so a person who has not yet learned to trust God fully, whether it's finances or health or whatever, is a person who has not yet overcome the self-centeredness of his life, because he or she is the most self-centered person you'll ever find. People who doubt, who fear, talk to them. I let you talk to some of them if they will agree, and you want to hear some of the sad states of mind that a lot of charismatics are in, that over a period of a year we minister to in one way or another. Their whole attention is centered around themselves, their family, their business, their problem. They haven't given up the self-centered life. That's where faith comes in, dear friend. Faith. The most self-centered people are the doubters, those who are anxious, those who fear to trust God. They speak of being overcomers, and they're being overcome by Satan, who uses fear and doubt to defeat you. Everywhere you go, you meet Christians that are defeated by fear. Christians fear everything. They shouldn't fear anything. God has not given you the spirit of fear. What is that? 2 Timothy 1:7. God has not given you the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. That is a firm, stable mindedness. Faith, in other words. He could have said faith. They fear everything. Accidents, sickness, financial loss, death, circumstances, criticism. Fear of criticism is one of the greatest hindrances to giving up that self-centered life. Because as long as you fear, and many, many do, fear what others think or say about what you believe or what you do, you're going to be bound, because you're just not going to do some things God wants you to do, take some stands, believe some things, because you don't want to be criticized. Now, this is no small thing, because I suppose most of us have to overcome to some extent at this point. If not, you could say almost all. I'm not going to make it all, because some couldn't care less. I know one, not that he wants to run over people, but he couldn't care less. He gave up a teaching position because he wouldn't compromise about a pagan holiday. And yet I've had to minister to people that were worried about losing their job over some little something or other. Want to know what to do? Well, I say just receive the blessing. Let them fire you or whatever. If it's a stand for Jesus. But you see, many are completely worried constantly about what others will think or say about what they believe, say about the faith message, our divine healing. And you see, faith can't mature in the context of worry or fear about what others will think or say. The devil will use that to defeat you, constantly being worried about what someone's going to say. You see, faith cannot mature if you're worried about what someone will think if you don't run to the doctor at the first symptom. Faith will never mature if you're afraid of what someone might say if you drop your insurance because you finally discovered God means what he says and he gives you assurance. I don't know why Christians have never raised the question of what did people do before they invented the insurance companies who have billions of dollars of your money that you'll never see. Back in the days when I used to have it, you don't dare have an accident because they'll either raise the rates 10 times what they were or cancel your policy. That's right. I remember years ago, thank God I can say years ago, on the insurance, but that's in the days I was humbled by driving a 1940 Chevrolet. I was really humble with that. I had a 40 Plymouth too. That kept me humble too, but I think the insurance, everything, comprehensive, the whole bit, was $35 a year because, you know, it was such an old car. It was a nice car, but old. $35 a year. And then I got another car, and the rates were quite low. But one night, we were awakened about 2 o'clock in the morning. Someone had plowed into our car and totally demolished it out in front of the house in Warsaw. I didn't have a wreck because I was in bed. I had nothing to do with it. Totally demolished. It was so involved they weren't going to pay, and we said, praise the Lord. That's when we paid for cars a month at a time, didn't claim them. We said, praise the Lord. Not only don't we have a car, but we owe for it. And the insurance company refused to pay because someone had borrowed the car without the owner's permission and they were getting out of it. Well, our company that was getting $30 or $35 a year from our insurance came and paid the claim. Because of our faith, we didn't worry. They came and paid it. I don't hear them knocking on your door in a couple of days and wanting to pay it off. They said, we heard the other company won't pay. We want to give you a check. Here it is. That's what faith will do. But the thing is, I'm getting at, when we got the bill for the next year's insurance, it had gone up from like $35 to $135. And I'm asleep in bed when they demolish my car. So People worry about what other people will think if they drop their insurance on everything. I ask people sometimes, what in the world did those first century, third or ninth century, or probably 17th century and 18th century Christians do without insurance and lightning rods and seat belts? I guess they just had to trust the Lord. A terrifying thought, isn't it? But it is a terrifying thought for most Christians. Now, you know that's true. That's one thing no one can debate. Christians are afraid to trust the Lord, and they're afraid of what others will think if they do. They're worried about what people will think if they don't run to the bank and the deadline is, you know, a day or two away and you say, well, I've prayed, I'm trusting God to send it in. Overcoming faith takes God's word seriously. It believes that Jesus is in control of all your circumstances, that all things are working together for your good, and it's just a quiet rest in Him, like Isaiah said, in quietness and in trust shall be our strength. That's what faith is. That's a faith message in a verse. In quietness and in trust shall be your strength. You see, fear of criticism will cause you to seek approval of the crowd. You're never going to please God when you do that. You'll not be an overcomer if you fear criticism, because you'll find yourself rationalizing what you're doing. Fear of criticism, instead of overcoming, you will compromise. You'll find yourself doing and saying and believing things that you know is out of harmony with the Word, so that you won't be out of harmony with the religious crowd. That's what I call the herd mentality. Yeah. Cattle. It's the religious herd mentality.
That's
right. It's sad to have to say it, but here's where most Christians are at. Oh, they wouldn't think of coming out of that old dead system when they get the baptism. What would people think? Or what would I do? Or I couldn't go to Glory Barn, I'd be criticized or whatever. And so they never get into the place where the message is coming forth or where God can mature them and bring them into an overcoming place. The herd mentality. That's right, it's like cattle. You'll never see cattle doing anything different. If one goes over here and starts feeding, the whole herd will follow. One decides to go at the barn, they won't stay out there and feed. They'll follow the leader to the barn. Herd mentality. Well, as long as you can laugh at yourself and not others, you can see it is not really a laughing matter. It's pretty serious. You shouldn't care what others think. Not as it affects you personally and your relationship to Christ and this end time move of God. Yes, you'll be out of line with most charismatics, but that shouldn't concern you. Not as it affects you personally. It should concern you in that you pray for them. And amen. I pray for God that He will take a certain group, for example, and take them deeper because they've stopped at Pentecost. That's an example of what I'm talking about. You don't just write them off, but you pray God will open their eyes. But you have to hear this message. You have to recognize what's going on, or you get caught up in the herd mentality. But you're going to have to come sometimes to the place where, like Athanasius, about a certain thing he believed, I don't remember what it was, but some doctrine, they said, Athanasius, don't you know the whole world is against you? He said, the whole world is against Athanasius? Well, he said, then Athanasius is against the whole world.
Yeah.
And you'll have to be there sometime. Someone sent me a religious paper. I get things like this all the time, but like the letters, you know, saying, now we're hearing these faith teachers saying that God will heal you with the medicine, when God is saying directly to people that He doesn't do that. And He says that in His Word. I mean, where are these men getting that from the Word of God? They're not getting it from the Word. And so he sent me this and a letter saying that might prove a little enlightening about where charismatics are going. It's sad, dear friends. This man's on television daily, radio. Here's where charismatics are going who are compromising the total faith message. And the title of the message is Super Faith or Super Foolishness. Then he proceeds to describe our church. It's our church friends, because no one else teaches the things he sets forth. And we know that he has us lined up in his sights anyway, because someone informed me, I don't listen to him, so I don't get this. He's came out strongly against apostolic baptism. Now that was a report to me. I'm not saying that's verbatim, but I've got it verbatim here. Super faith or super foolishness. And he says those of us who are willing to trust God are foolish. That God heals through the doctors. This is a charismatic on television every day. He calls it a peculiar teaching. He says, I consider myself one of the strongest advocates of faith in the world today. Then for two pages, he proceeds to contradict himself. If you would read it, you would see that he does. He says he's one of the strongest advocates of faith. But there's certain teaching today that goes beyond faith and gets into foolishness. Faith assembly. That wasn't in there, I added. This teaching states that it's a sin for a person to go to a doctor. Now, we have never said that. But you see, they never bother to find out what we really say. That would take months, maybe a few years, to get the whole message. It even goes so far to say that an expectant mother is not to have the care of a doctor, not even during the birth of her child. Individuals who have teeth that need care are to ignore the dentist and trust God to fill or repair their teeth. Someone didn't inform him of all we believe, because I don't know what he would have said if he found out we don't have insurance. There's a whole lot he didn't say that we teach, but obviously the brother who sent the letter said, you know, we know who he's talking about. Well, then he goes on to show how God could heal that way, you know, without a doctor, and could deliver a mother's child if she didn't have access to medical help. Now, here is a charismatic insisting that you should seek the medical help first. Then, if your case is hopeless and helpless, try God. It may be his will to heal you. Now, we hear this over and over and over. We've heard it out of shepherdship teaching, saying it's presumptuous to teach as we do that you can trust God to do what he says about healing or whatever. Well, but for one to instigate the doctrine that an individual does not have faith if he receives help from a doctor under certain circumstances is not faith but foolishness. Well, I wonder if he's ever read the New Testament. He says for someone to instigate, that means to, what he means to invent or to originate the teaching of the doctrine that if an individual, and he must mean a Christian here, if he receives help from a doctor, doesn't have faith. I thought that's what the New Testament and the Bible taught. The whole message of the Bible is negative toward medical science and medical help. Oh, we've said it over and over and over. We've got hundreds of tapes if you need any proof. No physicians or remedies in Israel. God said, I'm the Lord that heals you. Come right over to the New Testament. No physicians or remedies in the church. God said the prayer of faith will heal the sick. Lay hands on the sick, they'll recover. Are you sick? Call for the elders. Now, you're not going to get anything else out of the New Testament. And how these men can presume to criticize those who take God at his word is beyond really my comprehension. It really boggles my mind to think what these men will have to face on the day of judgment, because it's bad enough to lack faith yourself in the Word of God as a charismatic. I can understand under the system why you wouldn't, because I didn't under the system. I was cut up, patched up, sewed up, filled up with drugs and pills like everybody else until, well, you know that route. But charismatics to get on the air, this goes out, I suppose, to hundreds of thousands of people by now. Why, I raised the question long ago concerning the error of Jesus dying spiritually that some charismatics are teaching. Why don't people stay, assuming God gave them a ministry, we'll give them benefit of the doubt, why don't they stay with the ministry they've got? Why doesn't this brother sing his songs and Leave the teaching of the word to those who have the gift and are qualified. Because when they get into teaching, they get so far off. God told one brother, you're a prophet. You quit emphasizing the teaching. I've heard him say that with his own lips. And he's emphasizing the teaching. And he's off into this heresy of Jesus dying spiritually. I've heard him say, God rebuked me because I was emphasizing teaching. He's not a teacher, he's a prophet. There's a difference. There are different gifts. God forbid I should criticize God's servant. I'm telling you what he said God said to him. You don't criticize anyone if you say they're in error concerning the word. I trust you know the difference. If you don't, as I say, you'll learn it here, because we have to stay on our guard continually against charismatic error creeping in. How many thousands of people you think will be influenced now to run, oh well, praise God, they'll say, I've been trying to follow that faith book or those tapes or someone else that teaches a total faith message and trust God, but it's been 6 weeks, 6 months, or maybe 6 years for a loved one to be saved or whatever, and now I discover it's not a sin to help God or whatever. Now he goes on to say the medical profession is sponsored by God in his word. The biggest mistake a Christian can make is to embark upon a life of faith in the word of God, but at the same time to think he has to oppose the medical profession. Well, now, again, that isn't quoting what this church teaches. We don't stand up and oppose the medical profession. Why don't they bother to find out what we teach? That isn't what we teach. We teach that it's wrong for a child of God to trust anything but the way God has provided, and therefore we expect Christians to follow that way, God's way. If you're going to be here, you have to do that. I mean, you don't even have a choice. We give you time, and we don't come to you and say, well, you're not growing as fast as sister so-and-so. But you better believe we expect you, if you're a part of this work, to follow God and his word all the way at your own pace as the Spirit leads you. God hasn't said to set time limits on anybody, but you don't have any time anyway. It's now. You don't have any choice about, well, I'm a little slow. No, you can be slow in typing, but not in discipleship. No, we don't teach that. We don't run out and tell people sin and go to the doctor. We say that if a Christian goes to a doctor, he's sinning because God's word says it. That's a big difference. We precisely teach what the word of God says on healing. Let them give us chapter and verse. You see, he says that he's a man of great faith, and then he proceeds to show us what he means by faith. He has great faith to find a doctor in an emergency. He has a great faith that the bank will give him the money, that his ministry and corporation won't collapse, fall in on him one day. As one brother said, he had read this, well, that's another proof of the error of incorporation. You've got to compromise your message. You see, he's got the popular message, run to the doctor and pray. And because, as he went on to say, if he doesn't have this compromising message, he'll lose his support. If you don't think you'll lose your support, you preach what the word of God says. You'll lose it so quickly. This is such a miracle here, it's almost unbelievable, because we rattled around in a living room for years before you came along. Just believing God. Somewhere between a dozen and 20 foolish people. Never counted them because I didn't want to feel bad. You know, I'd never say, oh, only 12. Or I don't know how many there were, but there weren't over 20. I do know that. I wouldn't even count the chairs. I still don't, you see, because that's a sin too. David counted all the people and said, oh, look how strong we are. God sent a plague. You don't want to number yourself. And that's because we were preaching the word as we saw it. And so he goes on to say, God is not opposed to doctors. He is not opposed to medicine. He is not opposed to nurses and the medical profession. God has healed multiple thousands of people in the hospitals, taking every type of medicine there is. And if it's wrong to do such a thing, or it's disobedience to God, then God would be violating his own word by healing individuals by medicine and surgery. What a presumption now to charge God with his lack of faith. He's saying, God is doing this. God is doing this. And untold thousands are being healed on medicine in the hospital. And therefore, if it's wrong, then God's wrong because God's doing it. You see, we mentioned this morning about a syllogism. John had one, you know, you have a premise, and then a principle stated on the basis of that premise, and then you have a conclusion. If this is true and something else is true, then this is the conclusion. Well, you see, if your premise is wrong, then your conclusion is going to be wrong. So his premise is what's so popular, you hear it all the time, all healings of God, where there's medicine. Listen, find that verse for me. See, there, your premise is wrong. All healings of God, thousands are getting healed, therefore God healed them. That's your conclusion, but your premise is wrong. You see, if you say all wheels are square, and I've got wheels on my car, the wheels on my car are square, but that premise is wrong. But you can prove anything with the wrong premise. Evolutionists do it all the time. They'll get some schematic of some animal that is small and had four legs and little things that kind of looked like hooves and said, here's the evolution of the horse. It begins right here. But they don't bother to tell you that we had full-grown true horses at the same time they were finding those little specimens they said is the evolution of the horse, the beginning of it. Now, how could you have a horse evolving when the early stages, about as big as a rat, was still around? All sorts of inconsistencies. You see on some of these programs, deep sea diving and all, they found a fish now that he's an inconsistency. He's 80 million years old. He should have been extinct 80 million years ago. They found a fossil like that in a rock once. So they dated the rock. They date whatever's in the rock by the way they set up the schedule, by the way, on how to date the rock. You ought to study geology if you want to get your eyes open to all this big hanky-panky. Oh, it's a joke. So they found a fish in a certain strata of rock. Well, that has to be 80 million years old. And now they find them swimming around the Mediterranean. Here is a throwback from evolution. So if your premise is wrong, your conclusion will be wrong. He says God heals. All healing is of God. Thousands have been healed on medicine by surgery, therefore God healed them. Now that's a false premise that he can't base on the word of God. And he's charging God with being wrong if it's wrong to say that God didn't heal them. He's saying that would make God wrong if we say that God didn't heal them. Dear friends, all healing is not of God. Have you been here with the theology? There are two sources. There's more to say than this, but there are two sources of healing. The devil can heal. The Bible shows he does. And I've dealt with people who've been healed by the devil. Oh, yeah. He'll remove one symptom to get to their spirit or their mind or something more possessive. But don't show your ignorance of the Word of God to say the devil can't work a miracle. We could refer you to some literature where people besides myself in deliverance ministries, and I mean scholarly works, have dealt with many cases of where they were healed through Christian Science, spiritualism, and magic healing and magic charming and so forth. But we ought to know that here, that the devil can heal too, so all healing's not of God. He's saying that when the devil healed, then we ought to give God the glory, if you follow that line of reasoning. But you see, it's one thing to say all healing is of God. It's another thing to say that God permits healing at times through medicine and surgery. You see, in theology, we pointed out how the Word of God shows there is a directive will and a permissive will. God either directs every event as his will to bring that to pass, or he permits men to do things. Now, that's fairly clearly taught in the Word. So if we just get our theology straight, if we just stop being what we're not, teachers when we're evangelists or singers or whatever, that because people are getting healed doesn't mean God healed them on medicine or with medicine. It merely means God permitted them to be healed, because if he hadn't, they would have died. He permits a lot of things that he doesn't instigate. He has one way, the blood of Jesus. Why did he send Jesus to the cross if medicine and doctors would do it? They had them when he went to the cross. Why didn't he say, now he's going to shed his blood and bear away your diseases and pains, but that's just a figure of speech. The atonement can't bear away your diseases and pains. The medicine, the drug, the surgery, whatever is going to do it. You see, that's adding to the atonement. I mean, just logic could tell you this charismatic movement is all mixed up on healing like the churches. Thousands upon thousands, tens of thousands of sinners are getting healed on drugs, medicine, the hospitals. To follow his syllogism, God's healing them. There are people that think that. My Bible says in John 9, God doesn't hear the prayer of sinners. He doesn't hear sinners. He only hears a man that is not a sinner. The only prayer God will hear from a sinner is one that God by his grace has led in anyway, and that is repentance. Yes. There's a difference, you see. And so people who are not taught in the Word, they hear things by men that are popular and have nationwide television programs and whatever, and they're carried away. Well, he says, our teaching is this, and he goes on to give his, and it's just exactly what the institutional church teaches. He says, you know, that God can heal like that, but he says it very seldom happens. Let's face it seldom happens. He says, even the strongest men of faith at times have needed the help of a physician or of a doctor. He has no right to say that. That is making all of the saints of the New Testament contradictory in that they taught us how to get healed, call for the elders, lay hands on the sick. But he said even the strongest, Paul and the rest of them, he has no right to say that. He says it doesn't necessarily mean because a man goes to a doctor that they're weaker in faith than those who don't. Well, why doesn't it necessarily mean that? I mean, that is such a contradiction that it's obvious. However, if one has to consult a doctor, that person should not condemn himself. He says, this is our position. He should not condemn himself. He should not allow the devil or anyone else to tell him that he has no faith or that he does not know how to use his faith. He should not live under condemnation. See, he makes condemnation a bigger sin than doubt. Condemnation of yourself, you know. He should go to the doctor. This is a charismatic nationwide television teaching this. He should go to the doctor and ask God to give the doctor wisdom in respect to his particular case. And the Lord can do this, and his situation will be greatly helped. He said, for instance, though, if a Christian has to have surgery, now listen, you can see why they have not gone deeper with God and his word to make a statement like I'm going to read now. Like most charismatics, they have given in to the superficiality that so characterizes so much of Christendom. You know, just get saved and that's all there is to it, or just get the baptism. He says, for instance, if a Christian has to have surgery, it would be much better for the Lord to perform the healing. Now, what's his motivation? Eliminating much inconvenience and pain. As if that is why God's healing. To eliminate inconvenience of having to take off work, go to the hospital, and a lot of pain. He said it'd be nice if God would do that. Most of the time he says he doesn't, he can, and sometimes does. But he said it'd be nice if God would do it if you have to have surgery and thereby you could eliminate much inconvenience and pain. That isn't why God is healing, just to eliminate inconvenience and pain. My. You see, that was that last point we made a couple of weeks ago. But that's where Christians are stopping. He heals to heal. That's an end in itself. No, he isn't doing that just to eliminate inconvenience and pain. He's healing you because he put your diseases and pains on Jesus at Calvary. Isaiah 53, Matthew 8, 16 and 17 clearly tells you that. He's eliminated that for you, and therefore he doesn't want you cut all up and mutilated to get healed. He said it'd be nice if that would happen, but let's face it, if that person cannot quite attain the position of faith and receiving from God and does have to undergo surgery, he should ask the Lord to help the surgeon, and God will certainly answer that prayer. Well, the whole article goes on like that. It's super faith or super foolishness. He says, in all frankness and honesty, it would take an abundance of faith to believe for the filling of a tooth. Abundance of faith. Jesus said a mustard seed would move any mountain. You can see his faith must be so utterly impotent, small, that seems like a mountain he could never get over to believe God could heal a tooth. Well, I believe he can. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, he goes on to tell us we'll have many setbacks along the way if we try to walk by faith. And he makes a charge here that I pray God to forgive him. He's charging such teaching, really, to the devil. Yeah, that comes through. Well, the brother who sent the article, we got letters, many letters like this, friends. We don't stand up and read them over and over, the letters of how people are blessed and lives changed. But all to God's glory, may you be strengthened and encouraged to know that my wife and I are immeasurably blessed as a part of the body at Faith Assembly and through the tape ministry. It says he enclosed that article. He says, I'm sending it because it seems to me he is a prime example of what is happening to many, even those who have the baptism in the Spirit, if they compromise the biblical total faith message. See, this is what will happen if you compromise it. He says, I remembered the vision that was related here in the church about the denominational trees which were girdled about and going into Babylon. Well, I don't know if you remember that, but God gave a vision of trees. If you want to kill a tree, you girdle it. You tie a wire or something around it. It'll die a natural death. God showed in the vision many, many trees. All of them dying, many of them dead already. And said in the vision, these are the denominational churches. They're all dying. Some, many are already dead. All will die. The dead ones were plunging into the river and they were being carried into Babylon, which is what institutional Christianity, Christendom, the denominational system, is Babylon. We said that before that vision ever came. But God shows it to his people who are open to be willing to be criticized, to go back to the New Testament pattern. And that's why some of you, dear friends, very few of you, but I mentioned it last time, need to pray that God would deliver you from a denominational spirit, a denominational attitude, because it is a spirit that possesses your mind and you're offended when we hear tell it like it is, even though you don't want to be. Well, he says, many things can be readily noted by an overcomer when reading this article. That's right, many things can be noted. He says, it has surprised me that this man would take such a position from what I've heard him preach before. Well, you see, men are changing in these last days. You have to be aware of what changes are good and what are not. Well, he says, I'm not going to stray from discernment into criticism. I was drawn to pray for him that he would see the light of the Word on some vital points. That's the way you should pray. You should also be aware it's like bailing the ocean out with a spoon and only God can do it. It would take an individual like this a year or two just to get settled down to what faith is. Amen. Saying he's a great man of faith and then proceeds to contradict himself in that whole article, because everything he says can't be found in the Word. Everything he says. Jesus said he would bring a sword. He said, I see this sword as the pure word of truth, dividing those who will go all the way from those who will compromise at 20%, 50%, or even 98%. That's a good sermon topic. 1% of compromising is more dangerous than 50%, because then you and others are deluded into the fact, well, you must be all right because it's such a little thing you're compromising about. If you find me a passage in the New Testament, in the Bible for that matter, but in the New Testament, where Jesus allows anything but total commitment to Him and His Word and discipleship and faith, you find it. You can. Well, he thanks God for a message of total faith and total discipleship. Overcomers, as we said last time, are going to accept the total message of faith. Overcomers will. And so fear of criticism and losing support and a following is what causes men now in these end times to begin to drift away from the charismatic message of the Bible into these compromising positions. Instead of overcoming, you compromise. Instead of overcoming, you rationalize. You find yourself accepting what's out of harmony with the Word so you don't be out of harmony with the religious crowd. Now, most people are there. Most people are at that point. They don't want to be different. If you'll let me use an illustration without criticizing age groups, the younger generation, I just sit and laugh at most of them. Because they're rebelling against the establishment, that old solidified establishment that everybody is alike and they dress alike and they do everything alike. And I can't find a person under 30 that doesn't dress alike and look alike and even comb their hair alike and wear it the same length and so on and so forth and like the same music and, well, just go on. Now, that isn't criticism, because you could say it's true about the establishment, but they have their own establishment. I mean, the point is they're rebelling against conformity, and they're the most conformed group in the world. That is absolutely true. Of course, that isn't true of everybody, every young person, but I'm talking about as an age group. Conformity. Everybody wants to conform. No young person in his rebellion against the establishment and conformity doesn't want to conform. He doesn't want to be standing out there when the hair was long with short hair, with a suit on when it's blue jean mentality and whatever. It's just the way it is. He doesn't want to be different. And so to get with it, those who didn't want to be dirty in blue jeans, they started selling faded blue jeans so you could be with it and not be dirty. You buy them faded and worn and patched. And, well, you could say the same thing about older or younger. No one wants to go contrary to the way the stream's flowing. And Jesus is walking contrary to the current. If you haven't discovered that already, I don't know where you've been. I'd question whether or not you're really saved if you don't see that he's walking all through the New Testament contrary to the way the current's flowing. He's walking upstream. Everything everybody he meets is in opposition. The way he's going, what he believes, what he says. And if you're going to follow him, you're going to go contrary to the current. Now, that isn't a persecution complex, but he's the one that taught that you will meet the opposition. Fear of criticism will keep you self-centered. Your concern for yourself, your reputation, your name. You don't want to live in a neighborhood where they shoot at you or throw rocks because of your position. You want to be accepted. Well, the flesh likes to be accepted. But those who follow Jesus will give up the self-centered life and not fear anything, because you're going to trust his word, Psalm 91 or whatever, healing or whatever, finances, whatever. And the same fear of criticism makes people fear their circumstances, and that also ministers nothing but selfishness or the self-life. People who fail in a certain thing will tend to blame their circumstances. And circumstances can never defeat you or give you victory. Circumstances, you know what they are? We're in circumstances here tonight. You're in circumstances every day, every hour of the day, whatever circumstances you're involved in. Circumstances only provide us with the opportunity to prove what kind of a person we are in those circumstances, what kind of faith we have, what kind of a Christian you are, or if you are. Circumstances can never defeat you, and yet people blame you. No, you have to blame yourself. You see, Jesus said that giving up the self-centered life is giving up concern about your circumstances or criticism or whatever, or fear of these things we've mentioned. In Matthew 6, he speaks very clearly about a person who is self-centered because he is so concerned about his life in this world that he's spending all of his time trying to make ends meet, food, clothing, and shelter. In Matthew 6, 33 and 34, he clearly teaches here that we are not to center our attention on things in this life. Seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto this day is the evil thereof. That is, you've got enough to be concerned with this day. No one has ever overcome the self-centered life who doesn't overcome his fear or concern about his circumstances. You must be totally oblivious to them insofar as they affect you personally and would make you not trust God or displease him in some way. That's very hard for most people to do. So we're back to this teaching about what concerns everyone. That's why he mentioned it. Take no thought for tomorrow. Tomorrow is a word that causes the average person, Christian or otherwise, to fear and tremble. And yet the word is really a word that doesn't have any meaning, especially to a Christian. If Christians would just see that tomorrow never comes, why do they worry about it? Never comes. For what you call tomorrow, when it comes, it's today. It is always today. It's never yesterday. It's never tomorrow. You only have the present. That's why I said in 6:34, take care of the present. Live in total faith in the present. I think we've taught along this line that you're not unfamiliar with the fact that faith lives only a day at a time. Seek the kingdom and his righteousness and trust God just today, because that's when you're living. You're not living out there tomorrow. You're not living in the past. You can't bring it back. You're not there yet. When it comes, it'll be today again. So he's saying, trust God today. Tomorrow is a meaningless word for a Christian. Just trust me today, all the way, he said. Don't even concern yourself about the next step. Faith takes a step at a time. So why worry about the steps tomorrow when you're not even to be concerned about the next step? Just take it by faith. That's what walking on water means. You get to worrying about the next step. That's Peter's trouble. See, everything we do is along this principle. You build a house a brick at a time. You write music a note at a time. Books, I've written 10 of them, are written a word at a time. You can take my word for it. Word at a time. Meals are prepared a step at a time. You walk on water by faith a foot at a time. And when Peter walked a foot at a time, just took a step at a time by faith, no problem. But it's when he looked out there at the steps he had yet to take that got him in trouble. That's what Jesus is saying. Don't look out there. Forget it. Just believe I'm there. I'm in control. And that everything will be all right when you take that step. Now, keep a balance there. We didn't say if you're in business, you couldn't purchase 30 days ahead or something. Use a little common sense. You know of the principle that he's enunciating here. Don't be anxious. Don't be worried. Don't fear circumstances. Circumstances don't defeat you. You defeat yourself. Worry over circumstances will make you, like most people, a victim of your circumstances. You ever heard that term? Well, that's because they worried about them. Take a lesson from Daniel's three friends. They had to ignore completely their circumstances. Now, if you ever saw three men not concerned about their circumstances, it had to be Daniel's three friends. They were in the fiery furnace. They had to ignore them. They didn't say it's not real, but they had to ignore them. That was a real furnace, real fire. It was so hot it burned up the people who threw them in. Take a lesson. Trust God all the way. Trust him a day at a time. Trust him a step at a time. Take God seriously. Overcomers will. Christians do not take God seriously. This man does not take God seriously. God said what he meant about healing or finances and whatever else he's all mixed up about. He doesn't take his word seriously. He's charging God with the one who's healing with the medicine and by the surgery. God doesn't need those things. He can permit healing that way. We didn't say that, never did. But think how foolish his statement is. He says, is this faith or foolishness? How foolish his statement is that God needs medicine. That God needs insulin. God needs mutilation by surgery to heal. I've been cut half in two to get some kidney stones out. Thank God. That's past tense. God caused that? No, if I had known as a Baptist to trust God and pray the prayer of faith. Oh, you can believe I prayed. I gave up on the doctors after a while. I didn't know anything about divine healing, but I wasn't the dumbest person born in this world. When I saw the doctors weren't helping me, I just quit that route. Said, Lord, and see, I prayed that old prayer of unbelief that Baptists pray. If it be your will, heal me. If not, do like you did Paul, give me the grace to bear it. So he gave me the grace to bear it. As I tell people, actually didn't. He didn't even give me any grace to bear it. I just went around piously thinking he did. Hurting constantly. Hurt for 2 years until I read someone who was more enlightened than I was, like this brother, that God heals through medicine and surgery, and you shouldn't tell God how to heal. Go back and have another checkup. This time they found out what was wrong, because I was confessing it. I didn't know to do any better than that. But you see, that is foolish to say God needs that way. God may permit that way, but God doesn't need that way. He is telling people, and I cited some of the cases, and he told me that. What are you doing with those pills if you're healed? Those are my emergency pills. If you're healed, there'll never be an emergency. Oh, I didn't have to go ask anybody. I heard him speaking clearly right in my heart where he speaks. Praise God for the bread. God's giving you bread, friends. He's giving me bread while he gives you bread. So I was sitting in there praying. God shows me things, praise the Lord, at times. I saw this huge loaf of bread. Huge. Big as a house. And we were going in and out. Hey, wait a minute. You know what that is? He says he's the bread. If you abide in me, my word abides in you. We weren't eating of the bread. We weren't partaking of the crust or trying to get a few crumbs. We were abiding, living in the loaf. Now the Lord would have to show it. That isn't coming out here and saying, oh, we've got the message no one else has, but we're going to say what he says and what he shows us. Praise God, there are others who are biting in the loaf, but we can't talk about them. They'll have to do their own confessing and believing and praising God. But God is showing us that here in this end time, we're abiding in the bread of life, his word. We're abiding in it. Hallelujah. So don't miss God. Don't miss God. Whatever it is that hinders you getting all the message and obeying all the message, it's your responsibility to remove it. See, if God sent you here, he sent you here to do just that, to get into this bread, abide in it. You'll have to throw away those old dry crusts and stale toast and soggy things you've been feeding on, but it'll have to be your choice. God can send you here, but he gives you the choice whether you're going to abide in the bread. You can walk out from this bread anytime you want. Nobody will stop you. That's the amazing part about freedom of choice. Not freedom of will, freedom of choice. There's a difference. So choose to eat the whole loaf. Hallelujah. Amen. Stand with me. The Lord would say, except you abide in me, you can do nothing. Except you abide in the loaf, and I am the bread of life, you can do nothing. Without me, you shall wither and be cast away. Yea, I set before you the choice, the two paths, to walk in total obedience and total faith, and in total light, which I will give you, if you desire it, or the way in which the light will be extinguished. Yea, I will blow upon it and extinguish it except you receive the fullness of my word into your heart.
Amen.
And if you will do this, then your light shall be multiplied and become many lights, for you shall bear much fruit, saith the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.